The reading today is from the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 35 through 51. It's on page 1064 in the Bibles, bottom left. The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you will see." So they went and saw where he was staying and spent that day with him. It was about the 10th hour. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Messiah," that is, the Christ. And he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas," which, when translated, is Peter. The next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee. Finding Philip, he said to him, "Follow me." Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. Philip found Nathanael and told him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." "Nazareth, can anything good come from there?" Nathanael asked. "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said of him, "Here is a true Israelite in whom there is nothing false." "How do you know me?" Nathanael asked. Jesus answered, "I saw you while you were still under the fig tree before Philip called you." Then Nathanael declared, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus said, "You believe because I told you I saw you under the fig tree. You shall see greater things than that." He then added, "I tell you the truth. You shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man."
Paul, thank you very much for reading that. Do keep that passage open as we look at it. I think younger youth are heading out. This isn't just a rebellion and people are leaving before the sermon. Fantastic. I want to begin with a question. What do you want? What do you want? This is the very first time in John's Gospel that Jesus says something. It's there in verse 38. And his opening words are a question. It's as though the Lord Jesus is standing before us this morning and he's looking at us in the eye and he's asking us, "What do you want?" We want all sorts of things, don't we? I want my daughter to make friends at school. I want my job to be secure over the year ahead. I want my husband to get the all clear. I want to have the darkness of my depression lifted from me. I want victory and peace in Ukraine. I want to feel that life is worth living, that there is hope in this world. We want all sorts of things. We want important, precious things. But this morning, amidst all of those surface-level things that we desire, I want to persuade us that the best thing to want is to see Jesus more as he actually is. There isn't a single one of us here this morning who wouldn't benefit from seeing Jesus more as he actually is. Now this passage that we've got in John's Gospel is exploding with who Jesus really is. Look at the bold claims that we see together. Verse 36, we read about the Lamb of God who takes away sin. Verse 38, we've got the rabbi who teaches us wisdom. Verse 41, we've got the Messiah who rescues us from oppression. At verse 45, we've got the one who fulfills all that Moses and the prophets spoke about, the whole Old Testament. We've got verse 49, the King of Israel, whose kingdom will never end. He's the Son of God. Verse 51, he's the Son of Man, who came down from heaven to identify with us, with you, with me. We don't all have the same surface level problems, but at our heart, we all have the deep-seated challenge. What is it that holds us back? It is our small thoughts, our wrong thoughts of who Jesus Christ is, the only hope of the world. And what we see in our passage this morning is people like us discovering who Jesus is. Not any single individual in this narrative sees him fully, but each one is starting to see something of him. What do you want? The next words that Jesus speaks, verse 39, are an invitation and a promise. Come, he says, you will see. Before we consider this passage any further together this morning, let's just pause, let's pray that God would help us to come and to see this morning. Let me lead us in a prayer. Father in heaven, may we trust today that we will hear Jesus, that today we will see Jesus, and that today we will be moved by what we see and what we hear to love Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, as we see Jesus more as he actually is, I want us to see four things in this passage this morning. The first is this: Jesus comes to rescue. If you were here last week, you might remember that dramatic moment in verse 29 when John the Baptist says, "Look, the Lamb of God, the sacrifice that's going to take away the sin of the world." And now in verse 35 in our passage today, John repeats that to his disciples. Look, the one, the only one who can deal fully and finally with our sin. He's passing by. There's this real urgency and intensity in John's voice. He's saying, I want you to understand sin matters. And if you want your sin taken away, you must go after Jesus. That's why Jesus came. Christianity is an urgent message of rescue. And friends, I want to say to us, if we are genuine Christians here this morning, then at some point in your life, you will have grasped that Christianity is not just something that makes me feel better. It doesn't just provide a context in which a group of nice people can come from the local community to get to know one another better. There are all sorts of reasons why people begin coming to church. But if we are Christians here this morning, then at some point we have come to realize that Christianity at its heart is an urgent message of rescue. And we've begun to realize that you've begun to realize that you're a sinner. And you desperately need a Savior. And Jesus Christ is the only one who can save. That's where Christian faith begins, with that realization that I'm a sinner and I need saving. And John, as he passes on in our passage today, he's passing on his disciples to Jesus. And he wants to press upon them this important fact. As Jesus passes by, he says, this is the Lamb of God. He is the one who can deal with our sin. For some of us here this morning, perhaps that realization has come more gradually. For some, the awareness of our sin and the joy of forgiveness in Christ is something that dawns upon us slowly. But to be a genuine Christian, that light must shine in the darkness of our hearts. We need to realize that Christianity is an urgent message of rescue. Jesus came to rescue. That's the first thing we see in our passage this morning. Secondly, Jesus comes to abide. To start with, we have these two men, don't we, at the beginning of our passage. We've got Andrew, and then we've got this anonymous disciple. Most likely, this anonymous disciple is John, the writer of the gospel. It was common practice in ancient eyewitness biography for the person writing, when they occur in the narrative, to put themselves as far into the background as possible, to try and make themselves as invisible as possible. And so he remains anonymous here. Later in the gospel, he'll refer to himself as the disciple Jesus loved, the beloved disciple. It's the same thing going on. He doesn't name himself. And these two men, Andrew and John, they begin to follow Jesus. And then in verse 38, they're following him, they're walking behind him, and Jesus turns around and he asks them that question that we opened with. What do you want? What are you looking for? What are you seeking? He asks them. And in answer to that question, they say the most extraordinary thing in verse 38. Where are you staying? That word, staying, it means abiding, remaining, and it's a very significant word in John's gospel. They don't say, I've heard a bit about you from John the Baptist. Do you mind if we just have 5 minutes of your time? I know you're a busy man. Where are you staying? We don't just want 5 minutes with you. We want hours and hours with you. Because there is a longing in our hearts that cannot be satisfied without you. For some people, Christianity, it's a passing thing. It's like a phase of our lives. I can think of conversations, I'm sure you can too, that we've had with people. I did Alpha a few times. It didn't really click for me, and I just sort of moved on. Or when the children are younger, we used to come on Sundays, but they grew up, and we sort of just lost that habit and stopped. It's a passing thing. It's a phase, something that is fleeting. But what is going on in these men is a longing for something permanent, lasting, abiding. Where are you staying? And this word abiding, it's such a big word in John's gospel. As we read on, we learn about Jesus the Son abiding with the Father. We read about how by the Spirit, the Father and the Son, they make their home in people that trust in Jesus. They abide in us. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. It's a great word in a transient world. If you think back to our sermon series before the summer, in an Ecclesiastes world, this is a precious thing, a world in which relationships don't last, where everything seems to get recycled or consumed, where even if we do find something that we want to last and to endure, sickness and death interrupt it. And here we have Andrew and John, and there is this beginning of a longing for permanence. Where are you staying? Do you know something wonderfully encouraging about these verses? When God puts that kind of longing in someone's heart, there is nothing that can stop them following Jesus Christ. Rubbish Christians won't put them off. Really bad sermons won't put them off. Badly run Christian meetings won't put them off. All the things that we worry about so much in church won't put them off. If we were to tell our stories, those of us who have trusted in Jesus Christ this morning, if we were to tell our stories, do you know what kind of things we wouldn't say? We wouldn't say, well, I became a Christian because I was just surrounded by brilliant, perfectly consistent Christians. Or I just went along to a series of really well-run, organized meetings. We'd never say those things. There'd be stories of, well, God put a longing in my heart, a seeking in my heart. And in spite of all of the pretty inadequate Christians or sermons that I was subjected to, I found the one that I'd been looking for. I found that longing for permanence satisfied as I encountered Jesus Christ, the one who comes to abide. He comes to rescue, he comes to abide. Thirdly, he comes to multiply disciples. I love this description of Andrew in verse 40. He hears what he said and he rushes off to tell his brother. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him. And later in the next half of the passage, we have Philip doing exactly the same thing, rushing to tell Nathanael. And it rings so true to our experience, doesn't it? My guess is that for most of us here this morning, your introduction to the Christian faith came through a family member or a friend. Now, there may be some people here this morning who perhaps miraculously were given a dream, or maybe you were away for work and you're in a hotel room and you picked up a Bible and you started to read it. Wonderfully, God can and does save people like that. But in the vast majority of cases, if we were to share our stories this morning, we came to Christ through perhaps a Christian parent or through someone that we know. And so verse 39, Jesus invites these men. He says, come and you'll see. And then when they see, the first thing they do is they go and they tell. Philip echoes Jesus' words in verse 46. Having seen for himself, he goes to Nathanael and he says, as Jesus did, come and see. I love that song that we sang earlier with that repeated refrain. Come and see. I want you to note in verse 40 what Andrew says when he finds his brother Simon. Notice he doesn't say to him, I've just discovered this real peace and security that I want you to enjoy too. He doesn't describe some religious experience. There's nothing subjective about what he says. He says, note, we found the Messiah. Let me tell you, he's saying something objective. Let me tell you about this man that I've met. I love how John summarizes it in verse 42. He says, Andrew brought him to Jesus. That's how he summarizes what Andrew did. As I look back on my own life, I thank God for the friend at school who helped lead me to Jesus Christ. When I asked him on the school bus why he went to church, he didn't just say to me, well, because it gives me strength to get through the week, although that's true. He said, because I love Jesus. And he said to me, Ben, I want to tell you something about Jesus. And then over the coming weeks, he said, Ben, come with me to church to hear more about Jesus. He brought me to Jesus, and I thank God for that. Many of us will thank God for people like that. And this morning, I want to encourage us to be Andrews to others. I want to acknowledge it's really hard. I'm bad at it. Many of us will really struggle with that. And I think the reason that it's so hard is because mostly, when we do pluck up the courage to say to somebody, I want to tell you about Jesus, they're just not interested. As somebody's used the illustration, the analogy of, it's a bit like trying to light a fire with a bunch of leaves that are all damp and wet. You know, you're in the forest, you're trying to light a fire, you've got this pile of leaves, they're damp. You've got this flame, but nothing's happening. And it's like we go from pile of leaves to pile of leaves, and each one is damp, but then suddenly, we come across a pile of leaves that have been dried and warmed by God's sunshine. And it lights, that little spark, it's all it takes, and it blazes. And it is a wonderful thing to see in someone's life when that happens. Thank God for the courage and the love of those who have brought us to Jesus. And it may be that even this week, somebody here will bravely give some kind of testimony to Jesus. Might be at the school gate or to a neighbor, or perhaps we're about to go off to university and it'll be at Freshers' Week making friends. Or maybe it'll be in the workplace or at college or on the school bus as it was for me. Wherever it may be, and maybe God will just use us as one link in a chain as Jesus multiplies his disciples. It's possible, and it is a wonderful thing that that might be the case. He comes to rescue, to abide. He multiplies disciples. Fourthly, he transforms. Jesus transforms people. Real Christian faith, it involves a life-changing encounter with Jesus. That's what happens in verse 42. Andrew brings Simon, his brother, to Jesus. And John says to us here that Jesus, do you see that verse 42? Jesus looked at him. And that word look, it's a word that means he looked intently. It's not like looking at someone like you might on the train or on the tube, a quick glance. No, he looked at Simon. He looked at his life, into his very soul, as it were. And he said to him, verse 42, you are Simon, son of John, or son of Jonah. It's his father's name. You will be called Cephas, Peter. It means rock. A friend of mine likes to translate it as Rocky. It's a good name, good nickname to have, isn't it? And Jesus, as he looks at Simon, he says two things. Firstly, he says, well, You're Simon, you're your father's son. You are the product of your mum and dad's DNA. You're the product of your upbringing and nurture. You are who you are because of all that you've experienced so far in life. And of course that means, for those of us as we read about Simon, he's exactly like us. He's a bit messed up. He's a sinner. He's the product of all that he's experienced. But Jesus says a second thing to him. He gives him a new name. He's saying, I think we'll call you Rocky. What Jesus is doing here is really interesting. It's not that he's looked at Simon and he's seen an aspect of his character. This guy's really stable and reliable. And I'm going to call you after that character that you already have. And in fact, if you know anything about Peter, this is Simon Peter he's describing. If you know anything about him from the Gospels, this is not what Peter is like at all. Peter is not a reliable man. He's an up and down man. He's not consistent in any meaningful way. There's lots of very attractive things about Peter, but stability at this point is not one of them. And Jesus says, you are who you are, but in this life-changing encounter with me, you will be a rock. And for those of us that know how this story progresses, we see that, don't we? If you know the rest of the story, you'll see that wonderfully coming true. As Jesus dies and rises again and ascends and the Spirit is poured out, you have Simon Peter. And the day comes when he becomes more Peter than Simon. He becomes more of a rock than all of the things that he was in his life up until that point. And it's why we refer to him as Peter. No one calls him Simon Peter today. In the rest of the scriptures, he's Peter. He's the rock. That life-changing encounter with Jesus is real Christianity. And it might be that you and I haven't had a very memorable or very dramatic encounter at the beginning of our Christian lives with the Lord Jesus, as these disciples did here. But I want to say to us this morning, if we've not had any life-changing encounter with Jesus, if we don't know that at some point the Lord Jesus has said to us, you are who you are, and by my grace you will be someone different. If we've not experienced that, then we may not be Christians, because real Christianity involves Jesus transforming you from the inside out. Jesus transforms people. I'm not going to spend long looking at what happens the next day from verse 43 onwards, but just have a little look at Nathanael's encounter with Jesus. Philip introduces Nathanael, he brings them along, and Jesus says, here is an Israelite in whom there is no deceit, there's nothing false. And Nathanael says, verse 48, how do you know me? It's the most wonderful thing. Nathanael thought that he was the one searching for the Messiah, but all along, Jesus knew him. Jesus saw him under the fig tree, whatever that means. No one really knows what that means. Commentators guess what took place there, but nobody knows. The key thing, though, that's so apparent as we read this account is yet another life-changing encounter with Jesus Christ. Each of these stories of the disciples, the early disciples, begins with a life-changing encounter. But I want us to note that real Christianity always continues with an ever-deepening understanding of who Jesus is. Look at Jesus' words in verse 50 to Nathanael. Jesus says, you believe, and it's singular that you in the Greek, you believe, Nathanael, you believe because I saw you under the fig tree. And then he shifts, in the Greek he shifts. He says, you plural. He lifts up his head from Nathanael and he looks at all of the disciples who've encountered him that day. And he says, you plural will see greater things than that. And I want us to consider that briefly as our final point now. I think this is a real puzzle in this opening chapter of John. And maybe if you were with us a couple of years ago when we went through Mark, or maybe you've read Matthew or Luke's gospel, maybe you're aware there is a real puzzle in this opening chapter of John's gospel. The puzzle is this. It's the number of disciples who say, right at the beginning as they meet Jesus, all sorts of remarkable things. You're the Messiah. You're the Son of God. You're the King of Israel. The whole of the Old Testament was talking about you. They've just met the man. If you've read Matthew, Mark, or Luke, you will know that it takes about halfway through the story before Peter comes and says to Jesus, you're the Messiah. And Jesus says, wonderful, you finally grasped it. Isn't that a puzzle that here in John, they see it straight away? Why this difference? And I think the key for understanding this is in verse 50. These first disciples said that they'd found the Messiah, and they're speaking truly. They have. But their understanding of what that means is shallow at this stage. And it's why Jesus says, verse 50, you, plural, all of you, you think you've come to the Messiah, the King of Israel. You have, but you will see greater things. You will see greater things. Seeing in John's Gospel is such a crucial theme. As we read on in John's Gospel, we're going to find people who see, they see Jesus do all sorts of things, but they don't really understand. We're going to see this great irony that blind people will be able to see who Jesus is. And yet people who can see with their eyes cannot comprehend spiritually who Jesus is. Sight is crucial in John's Gospel. And what it means is that a relationship with Jesus, well, it might begin with a life-changing encounter as it did for these men here, but it must always continue with an ever-deepening understanding of who he is, ever-increasing sight. The invitation to come and see is not fulfilled in an initial encounter, but in lifelong discipleship, a lifelong abiding with Jesus Christ. And that's always going to be the case, because Jesus, he's the gateway into heaven. He shows us the infinite and the invisible God. That's going to take an eternity for us to come to grasp. And he's like a ladder, we're going to see this in a minute, he's like a ladder breaking in from heaven into our sinful and messy lives. And it's going to take a lifetime for us to grasp and see the significance of that moment. Which is exactly what Jesus is saying in verse 51. He says here, I tell you the truth, literally, truly, truly, amen, amen. Whenever Jesus introduces something like that, you know it's serious. I tell you the truth, he says, you shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. Now, perhaps those of us who are more familiar with the Bible, particularly the Old Testament, we might hear here an allusion that Jesus is making, an echo to something that happened all the way back in Genesis 28, where Jacob is on the run. Jacob's an idiot. He's a duplicitous scumbag. His name literally means a cheat. And he is. And he's on the run in this story in Genesis 28. He's on the run from his brother. He's really let his dad down. He's the very opposite of Nathanael, in whom there is no deceit. And God breaks into Jacob's life with a dream. And in this dream, God shows Jacob a ladder all the way from where he is in the darkness and the mess of his life, a ladder all the way up to heaven. There are angels and things going up and down, and God is at the top of this ladder. And in God's grace, he breaks into this man's life, this undeserving man. Jacob's not seeking God. He's fast asleep on the run, but God is very awake, very involved, very active. And what is it that God does as he breaks into his life? I love this. God doesn't dredge up Jacob's embarrassing past. God doesn't say, well, look, once you've got that sorted out, we'll have a conversation. No, God opens up Jacob's eyes. God breaks into his life, reaching down into the mess and the sin. And Jesus is saying to us today, drawing from this account in Genesis 28, Jesus is saying to us, I am the ladder breaking into your life. I am for you. I have come from heaven down to you. I am the whole heart of God flowing into your life. I am the Lamb of God who's come to rescue. And so everyone who has messed up, everyone who has squandered their chances in life, everyone who's got a past, everyone who's got something that they need to explain about their history, their background, Jesus says, I've come to rescue and I've come to abide. Believe in me and I'm with you. Whoever you are, whatever you've done, I will bring God's presence into your life. That ladder will break through. And Jesus is saying, if you need a new beginning, you can come. You can look at me and see. Come and see. There is nowhere you can go, nowhere that you can run to, where I cannot bring heaven down into your life. What do you want? It's Jesus' question for us this morning. Come to him. See him. It's what we need most of all. Let me pray as we seek to do that. Loving Father, would you help us this morning to see the Lamb of God who takes away our sin, to see the Rabbi who teaches us wisdom, the Messiah who rescues us, the one who fulfills all of your promises, the King whose kingdom will last forever, that ladder breaking into our lives from heaven, the Son of God and the Son of Man, the one who came down to us, who became one of us and entered into the mess and the brokenness and the sin in our lives to rescue and to abide. Would we see him? Would we love him? Amen. Amen.